Welcome the respected dignitaries and delegates to this third and final day of 46th annual National IAPSM Conference 2019. I hope the journey that commenced 2 days prior was remarkable for you and hope it concludes on a very high note. Without a further ado, let's begin with the session. We'll be starting with a session on EVIN, and I request Dr. Apurva to kindly come over the dais and start the proceedings. Dr. Apurva.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Here we will now start with our first presentation on EVIN, Electronic Vaccine Intelligence Network. For the presentation session, I would first request Dr. Sonika Ranaut and Dr. Preetu Dhalaria, the session chairs, to please come on the dais. Dr. Sonika Ranaut is currently a senior project officer UNDP and is running EVIN project successfully in HP. And under her guidance, HP is one of the best performing states as per MOHFW. Dr. Preetu Dhalaria is a physician and a public health expert. He is currently leading Immunization Technical Support Unit as a technical director. He has more than 20 years of experience in immunization and other public health areas. I would also like to invite Dr. Mangla Sood, State Immunization Officer, Government of Himachal Pradesh. For the presentation, I would now request Dr. Pradeep Halda to please come on the stage. Dr. Pradeep Halda is working as Deputy Commissioner Immunization in Charge for Universal Immunization Program with Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, since 2010. He also has experience of working at regional level with WHO IVD in CRO. Under his oversight, India has introduced several new vaccines such as pentavalent, IPV, PCV, MR, and rotavirus in very short time frame. India was successful in rooting out wild polio virus under his strategic direction. This success was critical for polio-free certification of CRO region. To strengthen the immunization program in the country, under his techno-managerial leadership, Mission Indradhanush was launched, which has played instrumental role in rapidly increasing immunization coverage of the country in recent years. He has also been cornerstone in strengthening VPD surveillance, including MR surveillance in India. He has several publications in reputed journals and has also participated in various academic events. Being a strong advocate, he is taking every possible step to take transition planning forward and utilize the polio assets for future public health strengthening overall. I invite you, sir. Thank you. I'll now hand it over to Dr. Preetu Dhalaria to please further moderate the session. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I welcome Dr. Pradeep Halda, Deputy Commissioner of Immunization, Government of India, to tell us about the most, you can say, effective and revolutionary intervention in vaccine supply chain, that is EVIN. Recently, Immunization Technical Support Unit has reviewed the program. And it was really happy to know that the return on investigation is almost threefold. So it is a very effective intervention, which has been carried out under the leadership of Dr. Halda. I request Dr. Halda to please let us know what is the EVIN and how effective it is for this immunization program. Sir.
First of all, I thank the organizer for giving me this platform. And I will briefly overview with the immunization program and then move into the supply chain. When we look at the program, it's one of the largest program in the world, where we are catering to almost 27,000 cold chain points across the country. And these are mainly in the different layers of the system, that's the state, district, and even in the district, the CHC, PHC, urban family welfare centers, and few of the sub-centers also do store vaccines. And then also, when we're looking at the supply chain, it's the cold chain and vaccine logistic management, which plays the important role in terms of its safety, quality, and availability of vaccines at the session sites. When we look at the program, And when we look at the program in 1985, we had only vaccine against 6 vaccine preventable disease. But today we have vaccine against 12 vaccine preventable disease, of which 9 are nationwide, 3 are subnationals. And when we look at these 3, JE vaccine by design is subnational because we are only doing it in endemic districts, which are endemic to JE. When we look at the rotavirus and pneumococcal vaccine, rotavirus vaccine at present is in 11 states, but we are expanding maybe in another 6 months period nationwide. So it will again become nationwide. The only other vaccine will be pneumococcal vaccine, which is subnational right now in 5 states, including Himachal Pradesh. So that we will take more time for expansion. So that's the, I would say, current scenario when we look at the vaccines. I have deliberately put up this vaccination schedule because the schedule that we used to follow has changed a lot. And this is the latest schedule that is there right in front of you, where we are providing vaccines right at birth within, I would say, when we are looking at BCG at birth or within first year of life. When we are looking at OPV, it is at birth or within 15 days. But when we are looking at hepatitis B, it is within 24 hours of birth. And apart from there, we have 1.5 months, 2.5 months, 3.5 months is the period when we ask these children to come for vaccination. And that's the time when we are giving primary vaccinations of OPV, pentavalent, and then we are also providing them with rotavirus vaccine. The other 2 vaccines, the pneumococcal and the IPV fractional dose, are given at 6 and 14 weeks. It's not given at 10 weeks, so there's an interval of 8 weeks for those 2 vaccines. Apart from that, at 9 months, we are giving MR vaccine now, almost nationwide MR vaccine. Measles is almost phased out. We are also giving a booster dose of pneumococcal vaccine at 9 months, the first dose of JE vaccine at that same period. And then 1.5 years, the child receives the second dose of MR vaccine, and then DPT booster, OPV booster, first dose, JE second dose. We are also providing vitamin A both at 9 months and at 6 and 24 months. And then when we look at 5 to 6 years, that's the period when we are giving the second dose of booster. And then 10 and 16 years, now we are replacing this vaccine, tetanus toxoid, with TD vaccine. It is tetanus with adult diphtheria. So this has already been supplied to all these states, and maybe another 3 to 4 months, we will not see tetanus toxoid in the program. We will only see TD vaccine in the program. And including pregnant mothers also, we are providing the TD vaccine. So it will be TD vaccine being given as single dose or 2 doses to pregnant mother if not vaccinated within 3 years. So that's the new schedule. When we look at the number of vaccines that we are procuring and in terms of volumes, it's a large quantity of vaccines that we are procuring. And when we look at these numbers, no other country procures that kind of a volume of vaccine. And in fact, it becomes also a challenge for the industries to produce that kind of a vaccine and provide us with this kind of a vaccine. I'm not going through the numbers, you can see those numbers, and they are in million doses. So it's a huge quantity, and that would mean proper storage, proper capacity to store these vaccines at different levels and see to it that these vaccines are being used in the program and available. It's not only ensuring that these vaccines are available, but available right at the doorstep. That means the last cold chain point, because this is a big network of 27,000 cold chain points, and anything can go wrong right from these distributions of national level to the last mile. And you may have adequate vaccines, but you may see that children may get denied of vaccination because the vaccines has not been properly distributed or properly handled. And that's the challenge that always is there when you have such a large program. So this is how the, I would say, the supply chain or the patterns that you look at. 27,000 cold chain point across the country. We have almost 80,000 cold chain equipments. And these equipments are ILR, deep freezers, walk-in coolers, walk-in freezers. And PHC, CHC level is the last storage point as a thumb rule. And this is entirely supply chain that you're looking at. And the last mile is the outreach sessions. And that's where, from the last storage point, the vaccine goes on a certain day and the vaccinations are being carried out. So it will be around 0.2 million immunization sessions are held, which translate into more than 10 million immunization sessions that are happening annually. So it's a very, very large scale that we look at. When we look at the immunization program, large cohort, and when many of the times when we look at vaccines, many of the people think that you just order and you get vaccines. No, it doesn't. If you look at vaccines like DPT, it takes about 3 months of production. If you look at vaccines like pneumococcal vaccine, the conjugation process, it takes a long time. It takes about 1.5 years. So that means if the manufacturer starts manufacturing the vaccine right from 3 to 4 months on one end to almost 1.5 years is the other end that the manufacturer takes to manufacture a vaccine. And therefore, if you ask suddenly, I need vaccines, you will not get vaccines until unless there is a proper thought process of advance raising the demand, allowing the industries to manufacture the vaccines, and then you get the vaccines. Unlike drugs, which has 5 years of expiry, vaccines like JE has only 18 months of expiry. Other vaccines has 24 or maximum 36. Very few vaccines like pneumococcal vaccine has 36. Otherwise, most of them are 24 months. And when we say 24 months, after the production, the manufacturers does an in-house testing, which takes another 1.5 months of in-house animal testing, and then they will send it to the CDL Kasauli for another 1.5 months. So even after production, there is about 4 to 5 months of gap before the quality is being assured and the vaccines gets distributed. And as an end user, I would say that even if I am saying that I am getting the vaccine right as a hot supply is coming from the manufacturer, even if it says 24 months, it will land up with 18 months. And if somebody stores in between the process, there is still a reduction in the shelf life. So these are the challenges of supply chain. These are the challenges of procurements. And therefore, many of times people think that there is an outbreak. Let's ask for the vaccines. But if you have not had a proper plan, if you did not stock it, buffer it, probably you may land up with non-supplies of the supply. So this also has to be kept in mind. So supply chain would mean not only ensuring that the vaccines have been distributed, but timely projections, timely procured, timely buffered, and ensuring uninterrupted supply as an end user. So these are all a part of important supply chain. So this is a complex picture showing right from the top that once the manufacturer gives the vaccine, it provides the vaccine at two different levels. One is the government medical store depots, which acts as the national buffer, and it provides to the state government. And these are on the instructions of the government of India at the ministry level. And once it goes to the state, then state has a series of distribution pattern. Bigger state has regional stores. The smaller state has directly districts, and then goes to PHCs and others. And the national buffer mainly acts as a soft observer, because when we are talking about the vaccine supply chain, many of the manufacturers, even if they have the supplies, suddenly would come back and say, sorry, I can't give you vaccine because my vaccine has failed. And when I was doing an annual testing, it failed the testing, so I can't give you the supplies. Or would come back because you are handling with biological product. They may come back and say, my harvest was low. And because my harvest was low, I cannot give you quantities. So these are the other challenges that you have to handle it, and ensuring that at the end of the day, the session sites do not have stockouts of vaccines. And that's where we always would put some buffer at the national level. So these acts as shock absorber, so that if a supplier does not supply vaccine because of whatever reasons, the session site does not suffer because of these ifs and buts of the program. So when we look at the entire supply chain, it is both push and pull. That would mean that we push vaccines to the states and divisions. And also, we expect that if there are any interruptions, the state and division would ask and demand vaccines that give us. And that's where we start using the national buffer to provide them with vaccines. So when we look at an effective immunization supply chain, it plays an important role in terms of seeing that where are our vaccines? Lack of real-time visibility across all levels, or no records of return vaccines, because when we were started the program in 1985, we were not having an open vial policy in spite of the fact that we were using multi-dose vial, and many of the multi-dose vial, when they are half used, can be reused, but we were not reusing it with the concern that it can cause AFI or quality aspect. But then when we started the pulse polio program in 1997-98, we started doing the open vial policies in the pulse polio program. We started the program in 95, but 97-98, we said, no, we will be doing the open vial policy. That means at the end of the day, the vials would be reused, and we continued to do that part. When we were looking at, in 2011-12, we were looking at the hepatitis B vaccinations in institutional delivery, we found that it was very pathetic. About 10 to 12% children were vaccinated in the institutional delivery. And when we started asking why these children are not getting the vaccines, the answer was that in my institutions, there are only two deliveries or three deliveries at the most in a month or in a day. And if I open a 10-dose vial of hepatitis B, I have to throw away the 10 dose. So we had to take a call and say, okay, in the delivery point, use the hepatitis B and reuse it continuously till you have followed a certain rules of reuse. That means 28 days of opening, BVM is intact, so on and so forth. After that, those experiences, we have seen no AFI was occurring. And that's where we started saying from 2013 that we should implement open vial policies. And that's the place where open vial policy got implemented. The quality assurance has to be there with the open vial policy. And therefore, return vials record maintenance, poor record keeping of stock and sharing of labels, and then short self-life of vaccines compared to the other drugs, and requirement of cold chain throughout the entire supply chain. So these were some of the important part. On the other part, I would say erratic and irrational distributions. Even if the state has the vaccines, but it was not properly distributed, or vaccines not passed down to the subordinate stores, and or cross-supply without intimation. So what is happening from two supply places, it going to one place. So all these things was happening, and these were actually affecting the supply chain. So what we thought and we included was, can we have an electronic vaccine intelligent network where we can see where the vaccines are? Let's see that this is available across all cold chain point. What it exactly is, it is basically, when we look at it, it basically involves people, it involves the processes, I would say the software processes or the hardware processes, and at the end of the day, there are some products that we are looking at. And when we look at it, at the districts, we will have a real-time visibility of both vaccines and the temperature. Your requirements will be predicted, your emergency management or your consumption patterns, or even you can make out your route plan where you need to distribute vaccines, or you could really reconcile your stocks and reallocate your supply chain. So basically, when you're looking at this, what we did, because at the national level, in 2014, we were only having vaccine visibility when we used to ask state government, tell us where the vaccines are. The state used to only tell us the vaccines which are there in the state store. They did not have any information where the vaccines are in terms of divisions or even the districts or below the district level. And therefore, we thought that let's implement a pilot into two of the districts. And we picked up Uttar Pradesh deliberately for the simple reason that we knew that this is a state where governance is not very good as compared to many of the states. And then Bareilly and Shahjahanpur, we wanted the frontline workers, that's the ANM, to look at, can we pick up some kind of database, and that's where we piloted the Evin. And with this successful implementation of the Evin in these two districts, Government of India decided to scale it up. And it scaled up right now in 21 states, 493 districts out of 700 districts that we have. Out of 27,000 cold chain points, it is right now in 19,401 cold chain points. And we have also not only put in terms of the software where the vaccines are, we also have installed digital data loggers. And these are the data loggers which transmits the temperature every 30 minutes into the system. And therefore, we also know where the what the temperature are of each of the cold chain equipments. So these are almost 14,000 data loggers has been installed, and we plan that by the year end, we will expand it nationwide to across all 27,000 cold chain points. This is just showing the phase-wise, how do we plan, scale it up and plan to expand nationwide. When we look at the entire event system, basically it's a platform through a mobile app. The person is uploading the informations into the system. It goes into the cloud server, and finally it comes back into our desktop computers where one can see all the informations which is coming. Even from the desktop computer, the person is able to push it up. So when we are looking at the real-time visibility, we could see the stockouts or excess stock or these trades or these points has reordering level, so they can ask for more vaccines, or there is adequate stock. So now we really know that who has more vaccine, who has less vaccine. We have been also trying to analyze in terms of these data, and we have seen that there's a timely reporting of 99%, which means that the cold chain point is doing a regular transaction. So we are able to monitor, this is the database across different states of timely transactions of the supply chain. And as on date, monthly, or these almost 19,000 cold chain points, 2.5 million transactions are happening every month. Now the question is that we have implemented, we got the visibility in initially 12 states and later on expanded right now to 21 states. So these 12 states were the first stage of introduction, and we really wanted to evaluate, did even made any impact? Is it helpful? Should we scale it up? And this assessment was done. When we look at this event system, basically after Government of India piloted, it picked up the Gavi as initial support. It's a global alliance for vaccine and immunization, and it provides support to for strengthen the health system in many of the countries. So India was one of them where it requested for it. And they said that they will initially support this part. So these 12 states where we introduced with the Gavi support, we subsequently looked into part that can let us do an assessment of those 12 states. But as on date in the Gavi HSS2, we also has now planning to expand. And as you have seen, 21 states that we have already expanded, and remaining will be expanding by this year end. So this assessment objective was to assess the programmatic usefulness of EVM implementation in the areas of stock management and document temperature monitoring and cold chain equipments, to document the program benefits and challenges of EVM implementation in terms of contributing to system effectiveness and efficiencies, or to evaluate the economic impact of EVM implementation, including cost saving of vaccines and logistic management, and to conduct economic benefit feasibility assessment modeling of the return on investment, because we are investing a lot of HR and technology. So is it really means we are saving money also or not? So basically the design of this entire study was pre and post implementation, because we had some states where EVM was still not been implemented, and other state where it was implemented, to assess the programmatic usefulness of EVM. And the comparative analysis of key process indicators was done for 12 EVM states based on the set of 6 months data from EVM implementation, another 6 months data after the implementation. So that's the methodology that we picked up. And comparative assessment in 3 EVM and non-EVM states was one been done. And the analysis of performance indicator was done to assess enhanced outcome in EVM states to compare with the non-EVM state. And then economic assessment of EVM in terms of did we had any economic benefit or not. And the 7 state with a post-study design separately from 1 year before EVM and 1 year after EVM implementation. So that's where we were looking at, and that's what we started doing. So let me see what the results were. So in terms of vaccine utilization by EVM system, we could see that almost what you see in a blue bar is almost 3,053 overall utilization of doses in terms of lag doses, and in the post event, the utilization was, I would say, better, and 30% saving in vaccine utilization, and which translates into more than 900 lakh doses was saved. And these are the 2 states where we are talking about. Similarly, when we look at in terms of stock out of any antigen, 30% reduction in facilities observed stock out before Evin with respect to the introduction of Evin. Similarly, instances for facility 40% reductions in the instances of stockout. Because when you look at the stockout, there are two things that one has to look at. One is that you may be stockout, but your sessions may not be the next day. Your sessions may, because when we look at the sessions happens after 3 days, after 4 days. In some states, they have one sessions in a month. In states like Uttar Pradesh, they have two sessions in a week. Northeastern state has one sessions in a month. So even if you have a stockout, does this stockout means, I would say, missed opportunity of vaccinating a child? So that part we have seen that even if these stockouts were reported, they did not really affect the sessions, because they were stockouts in between the two sessions time, and that's where it could mean. So when we measured the duration of the stockout, it could see that from the initial part of 13.1 days of duration, it reduced to 8.3 days of duration. And that duration reduction has been even more as we have moving and started improving the part. We also look at percentage reduction in the missed opportunity. And as I was saying that, when you look at why missed opportunity, why it will be reduced, because your stockout was only in between the sessions, two sessions, not on the session side. And these are the instances which was recorded through different antigen, which has clearly demonstrated that there was a significant reductions in the instances of missed out opportunity for the vaccines to be stocked out during the sessions days. Similarly, we were looking at facilities having discard of any vaccines, what we looked at, that 25% reductions in the facilities reporting vaccine wastages. This vaccine wastage also got reduced. This is some of the data on pre and post in terms of percentage of doses which was discarded into the program, and there has been quite a large reduction in the discard when we look at these vaccines. So vaccine distribution practices, indent response time reduced by 57%, because now it has become more order filled rate, because as we were moving up with the event system, so we were looking at, are they demanding vaccines? So order filled rate, marginal increase, or days left for expiry, 10% reductions in those part. The vaccine documentation practices, keeping record practices, has improved from 56% to 97%. Similarly, vaccine stock update duration again improved from 38% to 53.5%. So when we are looking at the completeness of the document in terms of indent registers, that improved from 26% to 69%. The stock registers, 29% to 75%. And temperature logbook improved from 29% to 70%. Accuracy in documentation, again, I would say that accuracy in the stock registers and entries were more or less the same that we have seen. The cold chain equipment sickness rate, that also has improved when we are looking at with event to non-event. Because what was happening is that at the event, the entire supply system was on a mobile-driven database, and that's mobile also got integrated with the cold chain maintenance part, so that moment they were having any equipment non-functioning, immediately through the mobile app, the information was going to the refrigerator mechanic, and then he knows, and that's where it also reduced the sickness rate of these equipments. So return of investment, because that's the question which always comes back, that when we have invested, so I would say return of investment analysis provides a convenient and comparable measures of efficiency of one or more investment choices expressed in terms of expected flow of benefit resulting from investment of resources. I would say in expresses both the cost and full range of benefit of an innovations, and then it has a distinct advantage of making investment decisions and simple way of interpreting the return of investment. So when we look at it, the current saving is almost 182 crores. We procure vaccine annually, almost 1,500 crores worth of vaccine that we procure every year. Total saving, almost 255 crores. And then return of investment is about 1.41 crores. As we will scale it up, the numbers will even increase. When we were looking at the event system, we have made it a very clear-cut roadmap of how the supply chain will be, where the supply chain will be, and there has to be a timely transactions, that means a monthly transactions. And when we are working all these, we could predict the consumption pattern of a cold chain point. And once we are able to predict a consumption pattern, we said that we need to move forward and go into a next level of event where it will be auto-indent generated so that we know that this database is, the requirement is as per that. So that's where we were looking at as a next part. We are regularly, I would say, updating and preparing these dashboards of different important indicators and being shared with the state governments. And it also contains those important parameters which is there. And these are, I would say, discussed during the monthly meeting at the state level. And these are some of the examples of those dashboards which are there on the fly. We have also developed an app on the mobile through which one could really see all these informations. And by downloading those apps, and it's a username and password protected app. Application also contains indicators which are required immediate attentions. All 375 districts where this database is there, so they are trained on My Even app, and they are using those apps. And the state and immunization officers can really look at all these databases. So this is absolute of the app part which is there. This is also a bulletin board of data which is also there on the TV screen and which is connected with the internet, so this continuously updates the informations and one can really see in terms of GIS mapping also and giving different color codes of where the vaccines are, how the vaccines are, and so on. So these are some of the critical informations. It's also looking at the equipment management component and what we have done it is all these equipments that we are looking at has a temperature logger, and each of the equipment's serial number is logged to the temperature logger. And therefore, when we are looking at the event system, we know that which equipment is not within the temperature and range, and really also can follow it up by saying that this particular ILR or this particular deep freezer is not maintaining a temperature or is at 40 degree temperature, and immediately we know that something is wrong and has to be handled. The order management part, as I said, that as you look at the entire supply chain and as your consumption patterns becomes predictable, you start now making an order intent. Because today, what is happening is people raise intent as per their gut feeling. It could be more, it could be less, and they just demand those vaccines. But as we have been using the event, now we know the consumption pattern of the cold chain point, and that's where they are now auto-generated indents, and these auto-generated, the next level has to either give the supplies as per the auto-generated. If he does not give it, he has to record a reason that he has not given the vaccine which has been generated through the system, the quantum of vaccine. And that's the next level of event system that we are doing it through auto-generated. That would also mean that as you have systematized that, your entire supply chain and your supply route also gets systematized, and you become more predictable in terms of the supply chain that's moving across. We also, as a future part, has incorporated barcode. These are 2D barcodes. But then these are all futuristic, because when we look at 2D barcode, the vaccine vial monitors, which is a separate part what you see, can also get incorporated into the barcode, along with all other information like batch number, lot number, etc. But in that case, the manufacturer also has to agree to these barcodes. Once that is there, the EVEN will able to pick up, because EVEN software has already have these barcode readers and all these informations. So once the manufacturers also puts in these barcodes and etc., this could be our next level of event where we could look into it. While we were looking at routine vaccines, we also know that we do a lot of campaigns. The polio campaign, which is right now starting national campaign from today, nationwide, or when we look at the MR campaigns. So we are also putting in the campaign module so that we are able to predict. We are also looking at a module on open vials so that we do it. Even improves plugin with the cold chain system functionality and also improves the efficiency of the cold chain system's health. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for this very informative session. I open the house for question and answer now. We have 3 minutes. Any questions? Sir.
See, when you are articulating regarding the involvement of private practitioners into the mainstreaming of immunization program, it's there right from 1985. Only thing is that government supplies are from the taxpayer, and therefore there are clear-cut riders. The riders are that it has to be provided free of cost, it has to be properly audited because you have to maintain records and all where you are keeping vaccines. And if any private practitioners agrees to that, we are open to that. And state governments are having those clear instructions to involve private practitioners where they agree to follow the government schedules, because we are aware today when we are looking at immunization schedule, national schedule, that's not exactly the schedule which private practitioners follows. So there are some variations. We wanted that they should follow the national schedule. They should have a proper stock. They should give it free of cost. So all those things are there. And once they agree, we share this.
Any more questions? Yep.
My name is Dr. Saurabh. I'm working in Padamala Medical College, Mangalore. Actually, what sir had raised the point, even if we are facing the same issue over there, all the private medical colleges in Karnataka have been told they will not be given the vaccines by the government of Karnataka. That is one problem. Because of that, we are forced to give the patients over there the paid drugs over there, which are definitely very costing to the patients. And if you look in Karnataka, especially Dakshin Kannada district over there, we have got 7 to 8 private medical colleges. There's no government medical college at all. I cannot compare Dakshin Kannada to other districts of India or Karnataka as such though. But hardly any deliveries happen in the government primary health centers. Maximum deliveries are happening in the private medical colleges only over there, and to some extent in the government Wenlock Hospital. So in such scenarios, if we are not giving the private medical colleges, though they are following the guidelines over there, they are fixed 3 days in a week, they'll be giving the government vaccines. Because again, the problem comes of, like you can say, the vaccine wastage over there. Fixed days, they have already fixed. If these days the kids are coming, they will be vaccinated. Other days they'll be coming, will be opening the single dose vials, which you're procuring from outside, and they will be charging it. So just a request, if something can be taken up with this for the private medical college especially, to ensure that the beneficiaries actually receive the benefits.
See, let me first clarify that missed opportunity is mixed vaccination. Whether you have a missed opportunity because of vaccine wastage, or you have mixed opportunity because of any other part, is missed opportunity to vaccinate a child. A child must be vaccinated at the first opportunity. As far as Government of India is concerned, and the instructions to Government of India is that because these are given to the end users free of cost, there is no charges. Therefore, the concern institution, if it is not a government setup, has to provide free of cost. There is no limit in terms of what vaccines, what quantity, what days. As far as Karnataka is concerned, there is no such limit from Government of India. It's the state government and the district authorities needs to see that these vaccines are being provided to those private hospitals or private medical colleges, and private medical college agrees that they participate free of cost in the national program. I don't see why 2 days or 3 days or out-of-pocket expenditures. It can be given free of cost, and it should be given free of cost. We have not limiting it, and we are neither demanding any funds or money to be paid back to government for those vaccines supplied to a private setup. We are not asking. All that we are asking, transparency, free of cost to the end users, and then we are saying follow the national schedule, don't follow some different schedules, because many of the people provide different schedules. Follow the national schedules. National schedules are, again, let me put it up, is discussed and decided by the National Technical Advisory Group on Immunization, which consists of experts. So we follow national schedules, and these are being discussed through our expert committee, and we would prefer that they follow those schedules. Otherwise, there is no such limitations. So I would say that we can take it up with the state government, and if the state government articulates to us, we can clarify those positions. Can you speak in the loud mic?
I am Professor Narayanappa from Bangalore. My junior friend who has suggested it is a good suggestion. When I was working with Manipal University, there was only one college, one at Mangalore and another at Manipal. Now there are so many medical colleges, as he said, around 8 private medical colleges have come up. And there also, as per the requirement from MCI, they have got enough beds in the hospitals. And if adequate vaccine is not provided, definitely the beneficiaries will not get the opportunity to utilize those services. So I request the concerned authority to take it up with the government of Karnataka and see what best they can do to provide the facilities with regard to immunization to the private medical colleges attached to the hospitals. It's a good...
I have already noted that, but also I would like to know what stops the state government from providing, but I have noted that part.
Thank you.
Morning, sir. Sir, we all know that Evin is a highly successful model, especially in the Indian context, but it is neither a new one and not is the last one. We also had e-Oshadi, and we also have Family Planning Logistic Management Information System. But if we look at holistically, this is the only model which has been scaled up to such an extent and has been so successful. So what are the reasons which you think and due to which it is the so successful? And what were the challenges which you feel were there, which will other programs will also face? Because currently we are also struggling to even supply good quantities of IFA tablets. We are struggling to do that. So how do you think in this?
See, you have, as I have said right in the beginning, that it's the HR, it's the technology, and at the end of the day, this information is not meant for me at the national level, meant for people sitting right at the sub-center level, to the block level, to district level, so on and so forth. Until unless these informations are not been uploaded timely, not been monitored timely or utilized, and putting in management principles into the system, the things will not work. And that's where I would say the importance comes into the play. We have sets of people at the state, at the district level, which we call it as even officers. And these are the officers who are moving into the field, looking into the challenges and ensuring that things are happening. So until unless you don't do that, technology can only bring in transparencies. But at the end of the day, what is getting into the technology? One of the examples, because of paucity of time, I have not got into the details. What happened is, I was sitting in my office one day, I received a call from the government of Assam saying I did not had X vaccine. Even system was in Assam. I was worried why the state did not had vaccine for last 15 days. Did the even not said? I was told no, even as showing stock out. And then I asked my people that we are talking about push and pull of supply. If you have seen that for 15 days there is no vaccine, what did you do? After an hour's time, the person comes back and tells me that the day they went stock out, we immediately supplied and they had received vaccines. I went back and I asked the event people that you have received the vaccine almost 15 days back. Why your system is showing nil? It was showing nil because the person has received the vaccine in his store but did not do entry into the event system. and therefore the entire state was stocked out and he did not distribute. So a good, I would say, system does not mean a good management. So a good management would mean your HR. And once your HR is there, your HRs have been monitored regularly, the system will work. Until unless you are not utilizing the database, the quality of the data will not improve. So I would say that when you're looking at Evin, you need to see that you're using the data are getting generated, and then once you see those shortcomings, you really get into those details.
Sir, I just want to add that as state immunization officer, this Evin software is quite helpful, especially in predicting the requirement of vaccine, because now the new component of cold chain has been added in this, which will be useful. So I just want to make a request if we can think of clubbing the Evin and the NCC-MIS software also, because that will be useful. It's very difficult to actually run two softwares on the same line. So that was just a request from the state.
Right. So I just want to take this opportunity to thank you, sir, for your valuable time. And before we conclude, you want to say something?
I would really like to thank Dr. Haldar that despite his busy schedule, he made it a point that he comes and takes this session and enlightens the whole crowd with the new technology that is so advanced and is so successful. I would also like to thank ITSU and JSI for giving the crowd this opportunity to be a part of this session and bringing it out. Even as sir has already said, it is not just the technology, it is also human resource and a combination of the databases, the deduction, and the utilization of that database that makes it successful. So with this,
So I think in the last, I just want to say that as we were discussing from the day one, I think it's very important for medical college, especially the students, to keep them updated about the immunization schedules, keep them aware about the interventions that are happening in immunization, and how best we can involve them into the system to help improving the immunization system. I think these kind of sessions are very helpful in this, and hopefully we'll keep these kind of interactions in future also. So with this, I think I take this opportunity. Thank you, sir, once again. And thank you, audience, and thank you, the organizers, for giving us this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, dignitaries. For felicitation, may I now request Dr. Mangla Sood to kindly felicitate Dr. Pradeep Haldar. Now I request Dr. Preetu Dalaria to kindly felicitate Dr. Sonika Ranaut. Thank you, sir. I request the dignitaries to kindly come ahead for a group photograph. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Proceeding ahead, now we have a session on Anemia Mukt Bharat, Intensified Efforts for Anemia Control. For the session, I request Dr. Shashikant, Professor and Head, Center for Community Medicine, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, to kindly come over the stage to chair the session. May I also request the speakers, Ms. Shikha Yadav, Dr. Kapil Yadav, Dr. Farhad Ahmed, Dr. Mangla Sood, and Dr. William Joe to kindly proceed towards the dais for the session. Thank you, dignitaries. I hand over the mic to Dr. Shashikant to kindly coordinate the session.
I thank the organizer for holding this plenary session, and the topic of the subject is quite close to my heart. We have a very distinguished panel of speakers here. The only thing I would request my speakers is please stick to your time, because the people have other things to do.
Show is yours.
No, we are already 1 hour late.
Show is yours.
Okay. So I would request Dr. Shikha Yadav from Ministry of Health from New Delhi to have an opening session on what is Anemia Mukt Bharat. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. It's a real pleasure to talk about Anemia Mukt Bharat, the newest strategy which has been developed and launched by the Honorable Prime Minister himself in 2018. So I'll just give you a brief overview of the strategy. This is the snapshot of anemia in the country. If you see that in last 30, 40 years, there hasn't been much significant change in the anemia prevalence among the major age groups. And if you see at the children prevalence of anemia in children 6 to 59 months and in the women in reproductive age group, it's still high, more than 50%. So that means that every second child or every second woman in reproductive age group is still anemic in our country. And there has been a very slow progress across the anemia prevalence across all the states. So this is a snapshot in one of the most important age groups of the pregnant women. If you see that 11 states and 2 UTs still have more than 50% of prevalence of anemia among the pregnant women. Similarly, 10 states have a prevalence around 40 to 50%, and then only 8 states and UTs have a less than 40% prevalence of anemia. So this is just a case building about why we need to focus on a newer strategy, or we need to repurpose what we have been doing till now. So the causes of high burden of anemia: low iron stores during pregnancy in anemic mothers, poor iron stores from infancy, childhood, and deficiencies, and adolescent anemia also. Dietary causes: we all know inappropriate infant and young child feeding practices, complementary feeding practices are poor in our country. Excessive consumption of iron inhibitors: we all know that after we Indians have a, particularly North Indian, we have a highly calcium-based diet, and then we have a tendency to take tea or coffee or milk after consuming meals. So that those are the iron inhibitors. They decrease the absorption of iron in the body. Then, and low consumption of iron enhancers as well. The low bioavailability of dietary iron, because Indians, we have most of a phytate-based diet, and we don't take food which is rich in iron itself. 50% of our population is consuming less than of the 50% recommended daily allowance of iron. Iron loss due to parasitic load, malaria, intestinal worm infestation again is a issue in our country, and we have been struggling to get rid of that. Poor environmental sanitation: these are the associated factors, as we all know, the social factors of sanitation, unsafe drinking water, and inadequate personal hygiene. Maternal anemia in itself is again a problem in our country, with increased iron requirement due to tissue or blood formation during pregnancy, and iron loss from PPH usually, and teenage pregnancy rates. Although we have made a few advancements and we have been able to reduce our teenage pregnancy rate, but then again. And then there are family planning issues also when there are repeated pregnancies with less than 2 years of interval. So these are the dietary practices in India. If you see the data from NLMB, which shows that average iron intake among children in 1 to 3 years, that has actually declined over a period of time. So we are moving gradually from a diet which was earlier used to be rich in iron, and now we are moving towards a less iron-consuming diet. Cereals and millets form the bulk of the diets in our country. Dietary intake of iron and other micronutrients has declined in the last 3 decades. Except for tubers and roots, the average consumption of all the foods has been below the RDI for the Indians. So talking about the public health implications of anemia, We all know that anemia can cause reduced physical development, impact on pregnancy outcomes also, reduced cognitive development, and it has economic impacts also. So the studies show that in the WHO and World Bank ranking, IDA is the third leading cause of disability if just as life is lost. Daily is lost for females between 15 to 45, 44 years, and it causes a loss of 1.18, around 1.2% of GDP. And the median total loss combined, the physical and the cognitive combined losses, are approximately 4%, which is huge in our terms. So, and if you talk about the cognitive development, there are studies which show that the diminished IQ equivalent in children who are anemic is around 5 to 10 points. There are impaired language and motor skills, diminished concentration, disturbance in perception, delayed psychomotor development, etc. Similarly, on the pregnancy outcomes, we all know that anemia, PPH, has been the leading cause of deaths of pregnant women. Around 20% of maternal deaths are caused by anemia worldwide. This is generic. The NTDs, we all know, the neural tube defects. Infants of low birth weight and stillbirths, again, are due to anemia. Anemia contributes to that. Anemic pregnant women are more prone to increased morbidity, and there is 3 times greater incidence of premature delivery in severely anemic women. Similarly, if we talk about the youngsters or the young population, if you are anemic, then you have reduced physical development and you have decreased work output and physical work capacity. The physical and cognitive losses due to ID alone in the region, Southeast Asian region, are close to around $4.2 billion annually in Bangladesh, India, and Pakistan, only these 3 countries. So we all know that how much this sort of a silent epidemic is causing losses, both economic and physical losses, to our country. So now, why we should address anemia? Again, the short-term and the long-term and intergenerational benefits that if we focus on treating anemia or addressing anemia at this stage, it would benefit us in the longer run. The improvements, they enhance human capital, contribute to a virtuous cycle of fostering economic development, and then leads us to the enhances health and nutrition of women and children. Thus, what is the goal of the Poshan Abhiyan, what we have learned yesterday also. India is also signatory to the World Health Assembly targets of reducing anemia by 50% among women by 2025. And the National Health Policy 2017 also commits to reduce anemia prevalence by 3% per year. That is an annual reduction rate of 3%. So these are the milestones in the anemia control program in our country. If you see, this is one of the oldest programs running in the country. Anemia control efforts started in the 1970s, and I guess most of the people sitting here, we were not even born that. The program majorly focused on supplementation of major age groups, and primarily on the pregnant women. The anemia level in various populations still remained high, so we knew that there are some issues with the IFA supplementation program. The coverage is, again, if you see the NFHS 4 levels, what we have the survey data available with us, it shows that almost approximately 30% of pregnant women only had consumed iron during their pregnancy. More than 50% cases of anemia are attributed to iron deficiency, that we all know. So 1970 was the first program, then when we had the 60 mg iron supplementation for pregnant women and 20 mg for 1 to 5 years of children for 100 days. Then in 1991, we made a policy decision and we shifted the dosage from 60 mg to again 100 mg. Then in 2007, we added the age group of 5 to 10 years because there were studies which showed that the anemia prevalence among this particular age group also, 5 to 10 years children, is also high, and we need to focus on this age group also. 2013 came the weekly and bi-weekly supplementation and the weekly iron folic supplementation program for adolescent age group, and also the National Iron Plus initiative, which was based on a life cycle approach. Like, we start from the children 6 to 59 months and we address women in reproductive age group also. This program also was primarily based on the IFA supplementation, but it added a component of the testing and treatment part also. 2018 is a landmark year when we had the commitment from the highest level. The Prime Minister himself launched these guidelines on 14th of April in Chhattisgarh, and the intensified NIPI program, the Anemia Mukt Bharat program, was launched. So we again went back to our protocol of the 60 mg IFA tablets, and now we are focusing again on the life cycle approach, but then we are focusing mainly on the test and treat approach, which was not there so intensified earlier. So the Anemia Mukt Bharat strategy has been developed from learning from the available states, practices, or what states, which of the states are doing what and how they are doing better from the other states. So if we see the learning from the best performing states of the district, the decadal change in anemia and pregnancy, few states show a lot of good improvement, like Assam, Mizoram, Sikkim, the northeastern state, the Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh. So we wanted to understand that what are the things differently these people are doing, these states are doing, apart from their dietary habits. We all know that northeastern states have a diet pattern also, which is high on the non-vegetarian and meat consumption. So that is again adding more iron to the in the body. So again, if you see the northeastern states, Delhi, Himachal, in fact, and Punjab showed an increase in the anemia prevalence, which was quite surprising and disturbing. So coming to what these states, which showed a more than 30% decline in 10 years of span, what did it do differently? First of all, these states had a target setting, interdepartmental convergence, and a regular program review at the highest level. I'll be talking mainly about the program point of view. Then these states, like we just now had the session on Evin. So these states ensured that they learned from the existing programs of either immunization or family planning services, and they made sure that they have adequate IFA supplies at all the levels of service delivery. They had intensified BCC and IEC strategies. For example, Assam had the Mission Tejasvi program, which was highly intensified, focused, and they used to have adolescent talks and rallies, etc., to sort of create a dialogue around anemia in the community. These states also had a monitoring and strengthening outreach services in the coverage areas. These states had the highest political commitment because they had their programs and the interventions launched or, you know, are committed by the their state health ministers or from the commissioners or from the district level magistrates. So their reviews and everything happening at the highest level. Then these states also had a special strategies for malaria zones. Now, if you talk about Odisha, for example, they had an intensified strategy where they combined the malaria intrinsic parts of focus of blocks and the villages, and also they had this intervention of anemia prevalence. So when they used to go to these blocks or areas in the during monsoon period, they used to test these people for the inhabitants for the anemic traits also. So that was a combined strategy which we have taken up in our AMB strategy. Then they also showed a screening and tag tracking high risk anemia cases and treatments. Government of India in 2012 had a policy of having a line listing and tracking pregnant women. We have a software special designed for this thing, that when a woman is coming for the first time during her first ANC, she is being registered and then given a unique ID. So this unique ID is being tracked and when till the time a child is 5 years. So we are basically tracking a woman right from a pregnancy when it is addressed and till the time the child is completes its full immunization. So there were gaps at all the service delivery points, even at the sub-central level or at the CHC level or the PHC level. And we were unable to track these pregnant women, that how much is their ANC coverage. So these days, basically, they strengthened these existing mechanisms and focused on tracking the high-risk pregnant women. These states also focused on the promoting iron-rich diet, which we have also included in AMB strategy. And there were obviously a combination of interventions that focusing on the diets and the IFA, deworming and malaria interventions. So the Anemia Mukt Bharat strategy is a 6x6x6 strategy. It's a good mnemonic to keep you remember these things. We are targeting 6 beneficiary age groups. We have 6 interventions and we have 6 institutional mechanisms, because this is the primary learning which we got, that unless you focus on the establishing strong institutional mechanisms, your issue of anemia will not be solved. So these are the 6 beneficiaries. They are, of course, starting from the 6 to 59 months children, coming then to the 5 to 10 years of children, addressing adolescent boys and girls of 10 to 19 years,
pregnant women, lactating mothers, and then women of reproductive age group. So now from the program point of view, when we started the strategy, so it is difficult if you see that approximately we are catering half of the country's population. And this is when we are not addressing right now the adult males. So, and these are the vulnerable age groups. So having a, such a large, huge target, it becomes a little difficult how to manage it from a program point of view. So we started that we will focus primarily on the women, among the women of reproductive age group, we will focus only on the newly married women, and we will utilize the existing platforms of family planning program, during which, or any other program of the community interventions, during which we'll be supplying or giving counseling also, and giving IFS supplementation to these newlywed couples. These are the beneficiary-wise targets of the Anemia Mukt Bharat strategy, and as we said earlier, that we are committed to the Poshan Abhiyan and WHO and NHP targets of reducing anemia prevalence by 3 percentage points. That is an annual reduction rate of 3 percentage points. And these are the baseline we have taken from NFHS-4, and then we have estimated our national targets as of 2022. So these are the 6 interventions. First is the prophylactic IFS supplementation, periodic deworming of children, adolescents, and pregnant women. Third is the intensified year-round behavior change. We have a campaign called Solid Body, Smart Mind, and focusing on the delayed cord clamping. Fourth is the testing of anemia using digital methods and point-of-care treatment. Fifth is the mandatory provision of iron and folic acid fortified foods in the public health programs. And sixth is addressing non-nutritional causes of anemia in endemic pockets with special focus on malaria, hemoglobinopathies, and fluorosis. So I'll be talking about 3 of these interventions here in detail. The IFS supplementation program, we all know it's running in the country since 1970s. The only thing we have changed here is that we are moving back to the 60 mg dosage for pregnant women, WRA, and adolescents. And also then we are moving from the enteric to the sugar-coated tablets. And this is the detailed the prophylactic dosage regime. Intervention 3 is the intensified 360-degree ICBCC for anemia prevention and behavior change. We did a field research, and what we could understand that there are 3 issues or the 3 key behaviors which need to be addressed if we need to focus on the program and make it a success. One is to increase the compliance to IFS supplements and deworming as well, appropriate IYCF, increase intake of iron-rich, protein-rich, and vitamin C-rich foods through diet diversification and consumption of fortified foods. And fourth is the practice of delayed cord clamping in all health facilities deliveries, followed by early initiation of breastfeeding within 1 hour of birth. So these are basically the programs or the strategies we have known since ages. But somehow we have not been able to actually focus in an intensified or a focused approach here. So this is the Solid Body Smart Mind campaign basis, based on which we have developed a lot of material which can be utilized by the states or for dissemination. The fourth strategy is the test and treat strategy. Like I said, that we are focusing on the POCT, the point of care treatment approach, on which Dr. Farhad will be elaborating in detail. The only new thing is that we are using the digital hemoglobinometers, and because of the logistics constraint, we are beginning of this strategy only in the two age groups of school-going adolescent girls and boys, who are the already ongoing WIFS beneficiaries, and the pregnant women at all ANC contact points. So these 2 age groups we'll be focusing on in the beginning of the program. And at all high case load facilities at block 11 and above, the hemoglobin level estimation will be done using the semi-auto analysis as usual. And we are thinking that this approach, if we see that it's successful, it may be later extended to other age groups as well with adequate platforms available. So these are the 6 institutional mechanisms, which is the newer, which forms the foundation of the Anemia Mukt Bharat strategy. One is the intra-ministerial coordination, because again, we see that the anemia prevalence, the issue of anemia is not just limited to one particular age group. It grows from maternal health to child health to adolescent and to women in reproductive age groups, thus the integrating the family planning issues also. Then inter-ministerial coordination. Second is the National Anemia Mukt Bharat Unit, which has been established at the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, RCS Division. Third is the National Center of Excellence and Advanced Research on Anemia Control. Fourth is the convergence with other ministries, which is an imperative issue. If you see that yesterday, you must have seen the Poshan Abhiyan program about the Poshan Abhiyan program. Anemia Mukt Bharat is Ministry of Health's contribution to the Poshan Abhiyan.
Fifth is the strengthening supply chain and logistics. These learnings we have derived from the existing platforms of Evin and FPLMIS, which is the Family Planning Logistic Inventory Management System. Sixth is the Anima Mukt Bharat dashboard and digital portal. Due to time constraint, I cannot show you right now, but I would request all of you to please spare some time and go to the website of animamuktbharat.info. It's a very good, interesting, resource-rich website you all can access, and it's free to use. And as is the first time that that all your program targets, beneficiaries and the targets are available online. There is a lot of communication material, and you all are welcome to give your suggestions to improve it also. So these are the targets-based monitoring which we have seen. We have focused on the existing, if you all know, there is a health management information software, HMIS, already available on the government platform. So we have picked up few indicators from the existing HMIS platform, and we'll be focusing and monitoring the program based on these indicators only. That's all online. So what's new in AMB, which we need to focus, is the coordinated management efforts, both intra and inter-ministerial convergence, target-based monitoring and key performance indicators review and awards also. Private schools also, we are hoping to rope in them. 60 mg instead of 100 mg prophylactic doses, and then sugar-coated dosage. Communication materials for the extensive awareness, intensive 360-degree communication campaign, the solid body smart mind campaign, to create a Jan Andolan, to create a dialogue around anemia in the community. Then use of digital methods of hemoglobin estimation and point of care treatment. And then we are also including the newer treatment strategies, IVR and sucrose and FCM, which Dr. Farhad will be talking in detail about. Then linkages of anemia with malaria, mandating the use of fortified foods in public health programs, and especially the DFS, linking with the academic and national and regional networks, and learning to make, include the policy decisions as per the feedback what we are receiving from the states and the regional centers. Thank you.
So, thank you, madam, for discussing the public health relevance, importance of anemia, and an overview of anemia book for a strategy. So, thank you, madam. So, now I will invite Dr. Kapil Yadav. So, I met him for the first time in 2012 in for 39th conference at Dr. Rajinder Prasad Government Medical College, Tanda. Then he was looking after another nutrient program. So now he is in another nutrient program. So I invite him to have his talk on what is this National Center for Excellence and Advanced Research in Anemia. Dr. Yadav.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Professor Bhadwaj, for the kind words. I'll be briefly presenting what we have been doing as National Center for Excellence and Advanced Research on Anemia Control, which is one of the six institutional mechanisms that Ms. Shikha just highlighted. So National Center for Excellence and Advanced Research on Anemia Control, or we call it NCRA, has been established at Center for Community Medicine, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, AIIMS, New Delhi. So briefly, most of you are familiar with background of AIIMS. So we are a medical institution or a university which was established way back in 1956. And Shimla had a very close linkage in establishing. Rajkumari Amrit Kaur was a close linkage. We are an institution because of her. Our primary is a trinity of mission, teaching and training, patient care and service, and research. There have been several landmark public health contribution by the institute over several years of its existence. Just to highlight the few are the National Iodine Deficiency Disorders Control Program, Integrated Child Development Services Scheme, which had its genesis in AIIMS campus, National AIDS Control Program, we have been the technical unit since its inception, National Blindness Control Program, home-based neonatal care, and now home-based young child care, and rotavirus vaccine. So see that these are the few seminal contributions, and our team under the leadership of Professor Shashikant, we envisage that what we have undertaken, anemia also would be added to this list subsequent. We have just started out on this work, but we are hoping with contribution from all of you in the hall, we'll be able to add that to this list. So what is the vision of NCRA? We envisage to develop and provide technical support to the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, for incorporating scientific policy and community perspective in policy and programmatic decisions for control of anemia. So primarily, we are working on behalf of Government of India. Whatever the requirements are from their side, with our technical expertise, we attempt or try to provide an answer. It is up to the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare to accept our recommendation and implement them. Broadly, there are six objectives that we have outlined for ourselves. The first and the foremost remains the technical inputs. Second would be the address the research needs, including the operational research from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Third is we do try to help them mount in program monitoring and evaluation, though not our core responsibility, but wherever and whenever required. The fourth one that is very close to our heart is the Apex Reference Laboratory. So I have subsequent slides where I'll just give a snapshot what we have done on each of these objectives. So we're planning to set up a national Apex Reference Laboratory for anemia at AIIMS. Fifth one is to facilitate capacity building for anemia control at program. And the sixth one, where the primary objective of coming to this conference was to support regional centers of excellence, which can have the similar model that we have been working for last 5 years, and we can have at least, we envisage every state should have a similar center for excellence for anemia. This is a theoretical, this is still not, it's a work in progress, what we envisage. We see ourselves as a knowledge platform. I'm not very fond of the word brokering, but for dearth of any better word. So what we look at is, we look at various forms of evidences that is available and try to provide answer to the questions that are raised by the ministry. So this is what we look at. So coming to the first objective of providing technical inputs, I briefly highlight what we have done over last, now officially we have been in existence for 1 year, but we have informally we have been working for more than 5 years now. So we were instrumental in providing inputs for the wonderful document that ministry came out. It's a seminal document as far as anemia control is concerned. So it's intensified national Iron Plus initiative or operational guidelines of AMB. So we had contributed several other areas, but these are the four highlights that our team under leadership of Dr. Shashikant was instrumental. So for the first time, we convinced the ministry to shift from clinical screening and treatment of anemia to test and treat. And there are several logistic issues in that, but they came around and accepted that viewpoint. Next was to have a methodology for point of care testing of anemia. So right now, digital hemoglobinometer is a device that has been advocated by ministry, but it has firm belief that there's still a lot of R&D that is required, and maybe we can have even better technology available for this intervention. The third one is a parenteral iron. So that has been sort of a missing link till now in anemia control. It has been accepted in policy guidelines, but programmatically the implementation is very sluggish. So the newer molecules, especially in global level, several new molecules are coming up. So that's we have advocated to ministry. And the fourth one is that's very close to what Dr. Bhadwaj said, my prior area of work, food fortification and salt. This is the first document where Government of India, that is Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, has endorsed iron fortified foods. Ministry of Women and Child Development does advocate it, but Anemia Mukt Bharat is the first guideline where Government of India endorses iron, Ministry of Health endorses iron fortified foods. So we held several camps that we call anemia test and treat talk camp, T3 camps. These were held in various places. This is Professor Vinod Paul being explained what is the rationale behind these camps by Dr. Ajay Kheda, who is the overall in charge of AMB in the ministry. These camps were also held at various other strategic institutions, at Nirman Bhavan, at Niti Aayog, at Ministry Shastri Bhavan. And one interesting finding was, even amongst these so-called better, economically better off bureaucrats and people working in these institutions, there also the anemia prevalence was same as national level anemia prevalence. 50-60% among women, 30% among men. So the message that got across to the policymakers was, this is a problem not of poor and downtrodden only, you are also equally affected. So you're able to send that message. And this is the slide on operational research that we are undertaking. So right now, in the current year, we are taking a multicentric study on ferric carboxymaltose. It's going to be a seminal study. There's, I don't think globally we have any study of comparable this scale that we are there. So four states and five sites, I think, in the four states are currently participating. And by the end of this year, we would have results available from this study. So we did provide some input to the AMB dashboard. Shikha has already mentioned. It's a wonderful website and a wonderful dashboard. A lot of effort has gone into building this dashboard, and we are hopeful that this will be used to its full potential. Apex Reference Laboratory, already we have secured some funding, manpower has been recruited, a list of biomarkers, and so what we envisage is one-stop shop for as far as lab is concerned. From wherever, anywhere in the India, anybody wants to get something done for anemia laboratory work, because that is a challenge we have faced. Once And something as simple as hemoglobin, if you, for program mode, you can get it done anywhere in India, but from research perspective, very few laboratories would be able to provide you even quality hemoglobin estimations. So that's where one of the challenges that we are trying to address. We are facilitating capacity building for anemia control at state level. We have been, as a resource person, participating, and I think till now, 5 states have already launched Anemia Mukt Bharat program this year. Another 31 are to go, and we as a team try to go and participate in each of these. This is a left-hand side is a picture from T3 camp that we held at state AMB launch in Uttar Pradesh. Regional centers of excellence, we have been trying to reach out, and we are very happy that the support that we have got till now from the AIMS at various state levels, and we are hoping other medical colleges also would join this. Dr. Vikas Bhatia, Dr. Neeraj Agarwal have been very, very helpful in rolling out this regional centers of excellence. Now, coming to the last slide, this is what we envisage in a coming 2 or 3 years we'll be able to address. What we see is from national level, we want to go to regional and state level, because we envisage we are a 20-member team at AIMS. It's not possible for us to manage 1.3 billion population of India. So we look forward to the collaboration from all 500-odd medical colleges, because the task is humongous. The slide Shikha showed, 500-odd, nearly 50-60% population of India is our target. If you have to reach out, just a fortnight back, ministry asked us to screen 1 crore or 10 million individuals in a 15 days period. I said no, madam. I couldn't even think of saying yes to that. But with the collaboration of all these 400 medical colleges, last year, with help of Dr. Surekha Kishore is there, with help of Madam and Southern other people, we were able to screen around 1 lakh people in a 2-month duration. But this time, their ask has become so much from us. So ministry is in a lot of optimistic this thing. They want us to step up and take that challenge and deliver. But it's up to our public and fraternity to deliver that, and that's what we envisage in coming year we'll be able to do. We plan to have a national epics reference laboratory working, and hopefully by the end of year we'll have a lab in place, physical space is there. We do propose to, this is an ambitious wish list, do propose to have a national anemia survey. Right now, a lot of debate is there, what is the exact percentage of anemics in India? Is it 30%, 60%, is it 80%? So there are various studies that throw up different numbers. So hopefully the survey would be able to address that. We are very keen globally, a lot of research is coming up on the non-nutritional causes of anemia. Anemia is a very interesting multifactorial classic public health disease. So a lot of interventions are there. Right now we are focusing on nutrition and that too only on RN. But there's a whole spectrum out there that needs to be addressed. And we are hoping that we'll be able to move from anemia control to optimal RN, micronutrient nutrition, or maybe optimal public health scenario, because that is where the intervention or the solution to this problem lies. Thank you so much. I'll leave you with this last slide. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Kapil, for explaining what NCRA is about. Now we will have what we are generally called T3 camps, that is test, treat, and talk. The talk part was added later on. So though it just says test and treat, it is our test, treat, and talk. Dr. Farhad Ahmed is a senior research officer at NCRA, and I would request him to talk about talks.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. So for another next 10 minutes, I will take you through this test, treat, and talk strategy under EMB. First, you already know that it is one of the 6 interventions under EMB and one of the most important inclusion in EMB guideline in INEP. There are various point of care testing methods. Some are invasive and there are new devices. Those are non-invasive. So they have certain advantages and disadvantages. I will not go through in detail. So basically, we have enlisted these methods. What is the advantage of these POCTs over laboratory-based testing? So basically, when we send any person, we diagnose a woman or a child with anemia, we send her to laboratory, and it takes some certain amount of time, and also there is some time lost to follow up. We the initiation of treatment, it takes some time. So this point of care testing, when a patient come to us, we investigate that patient, that person, through the finger pricking, and immediately we get the results. So there are certain advantages, like a small blood volume is required, can be used in community setting also. There is no loss to follow up. We immediately give treatment also. Ease of obtaining blood samples, because it is very easy to do finger pricking than drawing venous blood. So it is basically a faster method. Rapidly we can take clinical decision, rapidly we start treatment, and there is also chance of improved health outcomes. So as sir already mentioned that last year during September, during Poshan Maah, we organized various T3 camps in AIIMS New Delhi and other AIIMSs also in the key strategic institution also. So in this T3 camp, there are three components. One is test. Test means the test of hemoglobin, what is the status of anemia. Second is test follows by treatment, that is treatment of anemia, both prophylactic and also the therapeutic treatment of anemia. And there is one talk component. Talk component is basically counseling, behavioral change communication, just to our population about the iron-rich foods and what are the symptoms of anemia. So already Shikha mentioned that we have mainly three focus group. One is this adolescent age group, school going age group, that will be managed by RBSK team. Second is among pregnant women, which will be done by our frontline health workers during ANC visit, during Pradhan Mantri, Prime Minister Surakshit Matritva Abhiyan initiative or activities. So now I'll rapidly take you through this anemia treatment. One is prophylactic treatment and another is the therapeutic treatment. So prophylactic treatment, we know that in child of 6 to 59 months, means under 5 children, it is biweekly 1 ml iron supplementation, and each ml contains 20 milligram of elemental iron. So second is 5 to 9 years of age group, there is pink color tablet. Each tablet contains 45 milligram elemental iron, and there's recommendation is weekly 1 iron supplementation. For school going and out of school adolescent children, there is a recommendation of blue color tablet. Each tablet contains 60 milligram iron. All these tablets are sugar coated. So there is recommendation of weekly 1 iron supplementation. Next is the women of reproductive age group, pregnant women, lactating women. So for all of them, there is recommendation of red iron tablet, each tablet containing 100 milligram iron. So for pregnant women, so each tablet contains 60 milligram, the new guideline is 60 milligram sugar coated tablets, not 100 milligram. So for pregnant women, the recommendation is daily iron tablet for prophylactic dose for at least 6 months, and should continue till the pregnant woman delivers. And for lactating women, after delivery, 6 months. So this is the prophylactic doses, and rapidly I'll take you through this therapeutic doses also. For these three age group children, 6 to 59 months, 5 to 9 years, and adolescent, for severe anemia, we have to refer the patient to higher facilities or specialists, especially district hospital. For mild and moderate anemia, among children age group 6 to 59 months, there we have to give oral iron supplementation based on the age group. We have to see the hemoglobin level. We have to check it in 2 months interval. If it is improving, then we'll continue the therapy. If it's not improving, then we have to refer the patient to higher center. For this three groups, it is almost same. The interval is 2 months or 3 months. For pregnant women, the recommendation is if it is detected early in the pregnancy, then we'll start with IFA tablets. And the patient is, if it is detected a bit late in late second trimester or early third trimester, then we'll go for parental iron therapy. If parental iron, after giving parental iron therapy, we have to check the anemia status after 1 month. If it is not improving, then we have to refer the patient. For severe anemia also, if hemoglobin level is 5 to less than 7 gram, 5 to 6.9 gram, then, and the patient is in second trimester or in early third trimester, then we'll go for IV iron sucrose, intravenous iron sucrose, or ferric carboxymaltose. If the hemoglobin level is less than 5 gram, or patient presents to you with severe anemia in late stage of pregnancy, in late third trimester, then we have to refer the patient to higher facilities where the admission facilities available, because there is requirement of blood transfusion. So as you all know, there are various formulations of iron supplementation. There are tablets, there are capsules, syrups, and there are parental iron therapy. So Sarah has already mentioned that ferric carboxymaltose is a newer molecule. It is very effective. So I'll describe about it a bit. So first, when parenteral iron therapy is required, so initially we used to treat pregnant women by only tablets formulation or syrup formulation. So now this parenteral iron supplement iron therapies are newer modalities of treatment. So parenteral iron treatments are required especially for anemic patients when moderate anemia in second and late third trimester. Postpartum woman, if iron supplementation is not suitable, whether it is developing side effects and all, if there is requirement of rapid iron depletion therapy, and if there is any contraindication to iron therapy, patient is not able to tolerate the iron therapy, because you know that oral iron supplementation has lots of side effects. Many of our pregnant women, they can't tolerate this iron oral iron supplementation, sometimes because of taste, sometimes because of side effects like gastritis, vomiting and all. So in that cases, parenteral iron therapies are very effective. And other comorbidities, if there is some other comorbidities like related to absorption, if there is some problem with bone marrow responses, then also we can go for parenteral iron therapy. So FCM, that is ferric carboxymaltose, it has certain advantages over other parenteral iron therapies. First of all, this ferric carboxymaltose is basically metabolized in reticular endothelium system. It directly do not dissociate in blood stream, so there is very less chance of side effects. We can give a higher dose, like you know that IV iron sucrose is another parenteral iron therapy where we have to give either 200 milligram or at much as 300 milligrams. So patient has to come multiple times to the health facilities. And in case of ferric carboxymaltose, at single shot, we can give almost 1,000 milligram of ferric carboxymaltose. So there is, means through, if you assess the cost also, it is very economical. If we assess the manpower required to give IV iron sucrose, even for that lady, it is very economic. It is very, it requires very less manpower, and also there is logistic losses. If patient comes to you multiple times, you require multiple logistics multiple times, like IV cannula, your drip set, your fluids. But in case of FCM, you can give it in single shot. This component also neutral pH. It says osmolarity similar to physiological osmolarity. So overall, the side effects, the reported side effects in various studies, the reported the side effects are very mild. It is local, only itching, some form of irritation, and the systemic side effects reported is very less and is very safe. So to summarize, there are mostly the approaches to address anemia, we can summarize into three major categories. First thing is the supplementation, that is through our drugs. Second is food-based. So for food-based, we need to emphasize on that food dietary diversification that we have tried upon during our T3 camps. Another is food fortification. So there are various vehicles like flour, milk, salt, as you know, that many of these foods are already fortified with vitamin A or iodine. And third are few public health measures like improving sanitation, open defecation, free environment, improving the health education, like which foods are iron-rich, like we already mentioned there are few iron inhibitors, absorption inhibitors. There are few iron absorption enhancers. So if we teach our population regarding all this, and some, this also pertains to this behavioral change, and also the treatment of non-nutritional causes of anemia, like who come and identifying malaria also for early detection of hemoglobinopathies. So for this test and treat strategy, the take-home messages are: hemoglobin estimation essential for management of anemia, because many of the times even we do not know our anemia status, our hemoglobin status, so we should test our hemoglobin status. Second thing is the test and treat strategy is a newer strategy in Anemia Mukt Bharat, because we are recommending that at our clinical setting we should test and also give the treatment for patient across this age groups. And POCT, point of care testing, digital hemoglobin meter we can use. It is very effective. We can use it in our community setting also. We can diagnose anemia very early and can also give the treatment. Test, treat, and talk campaign last time we organized. Even we can organize similar type of camps to create awareness among our population. There is also some research activities is also required just to validate our various digital hemoglobin meters for regarding ferric carboxymaltose, ki how effective it is. There are studies, but still there are few other studies are also required. And also we should look upon, like Dr. Kapil said, already given emphasis that there are many non-nutritional causes of anemia. We should know about all these causes. We have to identify, have to counsel our patient, and we have to look upon all these non-nutritional causes of anemia. So thank you so much.
Before I thank you, Dr. Farad, I want to know one thing. Is injectable iron available under the program in some other states or not? So you must
First part, yes, injectable iron is available. Intravenous iron sucrose is part of a program in many states. I particularly know from Haryana where I work. So it is in the system. Ferric carboxymaltose has recently been added to the Anemia Mukt Bharat strategy. It is not yet under the program, and government, as Dr. Kapil mentioned, has commissioned the 5 site studies in India, and depending upon the findings, it might get approved for treatment of severe anemia in late second trimester or early third trimester pregnancies.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Now, we are all from medical colleges. So we have a great role to play under Anemia Mukt Bharat. So I will like to invite Dr. Mangala Sood, who is looking after this program, Anemia Mukt Bharat, under National Health Mission, Himachal Pradesh. Dr. Mangala.
Thank you, sir, for giving me this opportunity to present on a bigger platform. About the Anemia Mukt Bharat operationalization in Himachal Pradesh. So my earlier esteemed presenters, they presented us what is this Anemia Mukt Bharat program. Then we came to know about the National Resource Center and how the center is actually helping in giving the technical support and working on the guidelines on which the states are supposed to act. We also came to know about the new approach under Anemia Mukt Bharat, which was not initially in the NIPI program, which is a test and treat, and subsequently the talk approach. So I'll be sharing you the perspective of this program on from the Himachal Pradesh government side, and then what are the support we require from the medical college in the state, how they can actually help us in reducing this burden of anemia. So this slide has already been shown by the earlier presenter. What I am highlighting in this slide is, in the last decade, from the National Family Health Survey 3 to National Family Health Survey 4, Himachal Pradesh is one of the states which has actually shown an increase in prevalence of anemia in all the age group, whereas most of the states have actually shown a decrease. And in Himachal Pradesh, we have more than 25% increase in the prevalence among all the age groups, which I want to highlight. The prevalence of anemia is almost similar to what is there at the national level among the various age group, and it is most all the age groups, it's almost more than 50%, except for the adolescent boys, where it stands to 30%. And like we have been earlier told, that the target under Poshan Abhiyan, to which the Anemia Mukt Bharat is also a part, is to reduce this burden by 3% every year and bring it to a national target by 2022. So here I just want to highlight the data from the state, where I want to show that the prevalence of anemia among pregnant women is to the tune of almost 50%, and out of that, 26.4% is those who are having severe or moderate anemia. That means the HB is actually less than 10 gram per cent, 9.9 milligram per deciliter. And when we compare it to the iron folic acid consumption, we see that in spite of knowing that the women are anemic and we are promoting the consumption of iron folic acid, the iron folic acid consumption is quite low. And average, it is just 52% anemic women, the pregnant women are actually consuming the 100 tablets of iron folic acid. This is 100 tablets. Now the revised guidelines have come that they have to consume 200 tablets. But this is the Family Health Survey 2015-16 data when we were just sticking to the 100 tablets consumption. So in spite of having a high burden of anemia, the IFA consumption is still very low in the state. Similarly, if you look at the prevalence of anemia among the women who are in the reproductive age group but they are non-pregnant, the prevalence is quite alarming and stands at 54.5%. And again, the severe or moderate anemias are roughly 30%. They are having severe or moderate anemia. One of the important things which has come been highlighted as it come is the tribal districts are actually having more of anemia as compared to the districts which are in the plain. In Himachal Pradesh, we have 12 districts, and we have districts which are at a very high altitude. We have, like Lahore and Kinnaur, we have districts which are in the plains, and we have districts which are in the tribal belt. Similarly, when we are seeing about the prevalence of anemia among the children, under 5 children, again, the burden is quite high. 53.8% of the children, they are having anemic, and 30.7% are those which are having severe or moderate anemia, which is again an alarming picture. And this again is showing that the tribal districts, they are worse affected as compared to the districts which are comparatively in the plain area. So what are the state doing on this? Initially, like Dr. Shikha, my earlier presentation had said that the focus was on weekly iron folic acid supplementation. So now we have moved from there to also include the children right from the age of 6 months. So the age of 6 months to 5 years, they have been supplied with the iron folic acid by weekly supplementation. And for the children who are studying in the primary classes from class 1 to 5, they are also now covered under this umbrella of Anemia Mukt Bharat. And with the coordination with our ASHA workers, with our WCD department and our education department, we have started the program of prophylactic iron folic acid right from the age of 6 months in Himachal Pradesh. Similarly, the adolescents which were covered under WIPS, they continue to be covered in the support of education department. The pregnant women and lactating women, they are now provided with the iron folic acid tablets through the maternal head division, which is still continuing. The new initiative which we are also planning to introduce is to the iron folic acid tablet supply even to the women of reproductive age group which are not pregnant, and necessary instructions from the divisions, they are now circulated for the prophylactic iron folic acid supplementation among the beneficiary population. Another intervention which we have started is the deworming. So biannual deworming is done in the state, and the biannual rounds have started from the last year only. And initially we used to do just annual deworming round. So we are doing the deworming rounds on 1st of May and 1st of November every year. So these are the dates which we have finalized. We are not providing the deworming on the February and August rounds on the patron of Government of India. The reason being, a few of the schools are not open in February. So the dates decided in the state are 1st of May and 1st of November every year. And the deworming is done for the children, adolescents. We, for the pregnant women, we have also started from this year in the first trimester one tablet of albendazole. But we were able to cover about 19 lakh of our children in the initial rounds. And the next round, we are again targeting again 19 lakh population. The guidelines also say that we should include the women of reproductive age in this deworming initiative. So we are planning on how to include those women in the deworming round. So it's not yet decided whether it will be conducted in this coming round in May or not. The next intervention about the behavior change, intensified air round change in the form of solid body smart mind, that is also currently being looked after, and we are going for the mass media, we are going for the mid media, the orientation at the districts, at the field worker level, for the ANMs, for the Anganwadi workers, for the ASHA workers, that is continuously going on to signify about the burden of anemia. What are the drawbacks of having anemia? And finally, what can be done to reduce the burden of anemia, including nutrition and this iron folic acid supplementation? Regarding this delayed cord clamping, the instructions have been issued to the delivery points, to the gynae and the pediatric colleagues to start with the delayed cord clamping. I am sure the thing has actually started working, but I can't comment at this level whether every delivery we are following the delayed cord clamping as per the instructions, but they have already been issued. Regarding the test and treat campaign, the state is not able to procure digital hemoglobinometers at this stage. We are still not even able to do the tendering of the digital hemoglobinometers. We are sticking to the Sally's method of doing the testing. Like the screening camps for anemia, this were done under the Poshan Abhiyan in the month of November, and again in this Pakhwada, which is running right from the 8th March onwards, the testing and treating camps, they are organized in the districts at the level of blocks and in the villages. But we are sticking to the Sally's method, and the reason is we don't have any tender or rates for the digital hemoglobinometers. We had looked into the cost, and the cost is very high. Each machine actually cost 20,000 rupees, and the cuvets, which are the consumables, the cost is very high. Each cuvet cost about 40 rupees. So there are certain financial aspects which have to be looked into before we are saying that we provide these digital hemoglobinometers to the RBSK teams, and we provide these digital hemoglobinometers to the sub-centers, to the ANMs for doing the pregnancy testing. So this is also one of the bottlenecks where we need support from the government as well as from the technical persons. The intervention to do the fortification of the food, though it's mentioned in the guidelines that there is mandatory provision of iron and folic acid fortified foods in the public health programs, but when we are doing our meetings with the WCD, with the education, because WCD is doing the providing the supplements in their Anganwadis to the children, to the pregnant women, to the lactating women. So still they are not able to provide them with the double fortified salt. We discussed this with the education department. Again, the same thing in the midday meal. They are not yet convinced that they should actually shift from the normal salt to the double fortified salt. And then we are discussing with the food and civil supply department. So they are themselves not convinced that they should switch from this simple iodine fortified salt to the iodine and iron fortified salt. And you'll be surprised, one of their one of the officer in very high position actually had a very question. He said ki 50% of the population is anemic, but 50% is not anemic. So why should we give this double fortified salt to all when we know that it could also, those who are not anemic will also be consuming it. So that means there need to be some further discussions for further research at the higher level so that we can convince them. And the shelf life is also less. So in Himachal Pradesh, we are still not able to start this food fortification. For the non-nutritional cause, addressing the pockets of hemoglobinopathies. So this year we are planning to start with the testing for the hemoglobinopathies in the school children in the classes 8th, 9th and 10th. So that is in the pipeline, and I'm very hopeful that we will be able to start it in this financial year. So this we have already linked. So we know the guidelines have been released. The National Center of Excellence has been established in AIIMS, and the convergence is there with the ministries. Himachal Pradesh has not yet launched this program, though we are actually working on the ground level to ensure that all the 6x6 mechanism is actually on the ground before we actually launch this program in the state. And the convergence is being planned with the ministries. We call them and discuss with them regarding what has to be done in the state. There is another issue of procurement. This is actually the backbone, the iron folic acid supplementation. For that, we need to have a regular supply of iron and folic acid. In the state, actually, this is one of the weak link because we still are not able to finalize with the tenders of this medicines, syrups as well as the medicines. This is one of the weak link which we are working on. The dashboard has been established and we are actually looking at the dashboard and on the basis of which we are finding what are the gaps which we need to work more. The key performance indicators have already been communicated to the districts so that they know that what is to be specifically looked in the HMIS portal on this Anemia Mukt Bharat initiative. So these are the minutes, like we have done a meeting first with the Niti Aayog and Dr. M.K. Bhan. He was there in Himachal Pradesh and we had a meeting with all the convergent departments on how to work on the program at the ground level. And similarly, we had meetings in November, we had meetings in January to actually sort out the bottleneck analysis. So the role of medical colleges, a lot of support is actually required in this program from the medical colleges perspective. First and foremost is the data which is actually supplied by the National Family Health Survey and the data which we collect from the ICDS department. That is not at all matching. So there is a mismatch in the data. So if they can actually validate a small proportion of this data, even 0.5 to 1% of the total children actually, to find out what is the factual figure, like the survey and the ICDS data, why there is a difference and how can we reduce this error. So anyone from the PSM department can take this as a thesis part and the government is ready to support them on this. Then there are different methods to actually diagnose anemia. For a general population, they are different diagnostic tests. For the pregnant female, they actually say we should change to a different diagnostic method. So whether we should still stick to the old Sally's method, which is available in the state and we are doing on the basis of this only, or should we actually move to the color-coded hemoglobin testing strips, digital hemoglobinometers, or cyanamide hemoglobin test methods. So this is one of the field where we actually need support from the medical colleges if they can actually validate the methods for the population of Himachal and say that, yeah, this is actually feasible also, and this method is actually within our financial budget also where we can test it. The third is why there is so much high burden of anemia in Himachal Pradesh. Like I show you, many of the tribal districts and those which are actually at a height are showing highest burden of anemia, which is quite surprising because we always have this belief that the tribal people, they have a good nutrition, they are non-vegetarian, plus they live at a height. So ideally their hemoglobin should have been better as compared to those which live in plains, but in Himachal, this is not that. So if some study or research can be done on that for finding out what is the reason for this high burden of anemia and why among selected districts. Then I show you a slide in which I said that though the burden of anemia is quite big, but still the iron folic acid consumption is very low in the state. In spite of availability and in spite of the counseling done at the time of giving tablets. So how we can improve the compliance of IFA tablets among various age groups in the state. Then a WIFS program is running since last 4-5 years, but why it's not showing any improvement in hemoglobin among the adolescents. Then I've already discussed that Food and Civil Supply Department, they have their own inhibitions on going ahead with the tenders for the food fortification. So how can we actually convince them on that? In these high burden districts, we also need support from the medical colleges, from the graduate, from the postgraduate students, if they can actually do the test and treat camps and the talk camps. and discussions on the burden of anemia in these districts which have got prevalence even more than 50%, so that we can actually reduce this moderate anemia by 50% in the coming years. So this is some of the support where we actually require from the medical colleges in bringing down the burden of anemia. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mangla, for very nice presentation and bringing out clearly that anemia may be distributed differently in different geographical location, and particularly your tribal districts. So you've got a reasonable research agenda also identified. Thank you for that. And now we will have the last presentation from Dr. William Jo, and he'll be talking about improving diets as a part of Anemia Mukt Bharat.
Professor Sashikant, Professor Bhardwaj, distinguished speakers and conference participants, a very good morning to you all. Let me begin by thanking Professor Sashikant and Dr. Kapil for inviting me to join this panel. We at the Population Research Center of the Institute of Economic Growth are also supporting the ministry in the rollout of Anemia Mukt Bharat. This particular presentation is based on a vital component of diets, which we feel that diets is a very, very important source how we get certain macronutrients and micronutrients in our body. So we will try to present some broad descriptives from large-scale survey data to see what is the current pattern in India and what are the certain policy directions in terms of action as well as in terms of daily life course activities which can help us in improving the diets and to eliminate certain micronutrient deficiencies in our bodies. Recently, the Lancet had brought out this Eat Lancet Commission report, which defines a healthy diet should be something that optimizes health. So in accordance with the WHO definition of health, we should also focus on diet which will be good for our health. And it broadly recommends a diet. We know that there are age-sex variations around what should be a diet composition for an individual, and also there are climatic considerations, but in general, we can see that the diet should be composed of a good amount of protein, a good amount of healthy fats, and a good amount of whole grains. Now, we can juxtapose this with the pattern that we see for India. Let's see the pattern for rural India first. We will see that in 93-94 or even in 2011-12, our diet in rural India was very much cereal-centric. Like about 60% of the diet currently is also on an average cereal-based. Very, very small consumption of protein-based foods and very small consumption of milk and milk products. So the pattern has not much changed in rural India. In urban India, again, we find that a heavy dependence on cereals. And the consumption of oil and fat has increased in the last 20 years or so. So we are seeing a diet pattern which is very much different from a broadly like recommended kind of pattern, very much cereal-centric diet, and a trend of growing intake of oils and fats. There is not much uptake of fresh fruits and vegetables or protein-rich foods. So this is an important message that is coming out from the data that nothing much has changed. The pattern is very much different from what a usually healthy diet pattern should be like. Now, since being an economist, we also try to look at this from an income perspective. If you will look at the calorie intake pattern or the protein intake pattern or the fat intake pattern by income, we will see that as the income of the household will increase, they tend to consume more of these products. Now, what is more interesting is to observe that the fat intake is going up much more rapidly. The calorie as well as protein intake, it actually stabilizes after a particular level of income, but the fat intake is not stabilizing, and it is increasing at a much more higher rate. The consumption is much higher in urban parts than compared to rural parts. In economics, we apply a concept called elasticity to understand what is the sensitivity of income changes to the consumption changes of these particular products. So a 1% increase in income should lead to how much percentage increase in the intake of these products. So we see that the calorie and protein intake elasticities are very low. That is, as income of the household is increasing, they are
consuming less and less of these products. But a worrisome trend is noted in terms of fat consumption, that an increasing proportion of income is actually leading to much higher consumption of fat, and it is not declining at a rate at which calorie or protein intake is declining. Consequently, what is happening is that our fat consumption is not coming down in a way which is supposed to be fitting with the broader trend of a healthy diet composition, whereas protein is very much sensitive and it is not going up in the Indian context. So our diet pattern, we need to have much more changes in terms of what to consume and what composition and quantity both to consume. Just to take this step forward, we are trying to look at the diet pattern which we will be likely to observe in near future. So a projection exercise we carried out, and we see that our calorie and protein intake will be stabilizing somewhere near in next 20 years. Since India is still a growing country, there are a lot of poor people still who will be consuming more of these products. And these things will stabilize in the next 20 years. But the fat intake is not likely to stabilize in the next 20 years. It is likely to carry on increasing up to next 40 years or so. So this is something which we have to consider. Although fats are supposed to be healthy, but the nature of composition of the fat diet which we are consuming does not fit that criteria. So that is something which we have to highlight and work towards as policy makers, as practitioners, who can help in improving our diet profile. Now, given the broad trend that our consumption is too much cereal-centric and the basket itself is not very healthy, we will focus on two broad groups which are of high policy relevance from Anemia Mukt Bharat perspective. One is the diet diversity among children, and second, we will look at diet intake among men and women. So, just to broadly give you some idea about what our children are eating. So this is the data from National Family Health Survey. Here we see that children are largely being given food from like different grains, or maybe rice and wheat, and some milk products. But the consumption of fruits and vegetables is very low. One in every three child gets to eat fruits or vegetables. When you come to protein-rich food like eggs or fish, poultry, meat, etc., only one in every 10 child is given these things on a daily basis. So notwithstanding the data issues around this, but we broadly see that only one in every four child is getting adequate diet which is diverse and which can be said to be fulfilling the criteria of minimum dietary diversity. And when you combine this criteria of dietary diversity with the frequency of diet, we find that only one children out of all 10 children are getting acceptable diet. So our diet composition is very, very poor in the sense that we are not eating from different groups, and also we are not eating in right frequencies. So this is actually associated with a lot of nutrition-related issues which we largely discuss in the form of anthropometric failure, or here in this context of anemia prevalence. If you will look at the diet diversity profile for children from a geographical perspective, you will see that the blue shaded regions which are showing better diet profile, these are largely concentrated among the coastal line and northeast part of the country, and so to some extent in the northern part. So these are having better diversity compared to the entire central India or the western part. Especially if you will see at regions which are supposed to be dry, semi-arid regions like Rajasthan, interior, MP, Maharashtra and all, the dietary diversity is very, very low. So this is something worth to be linked with our agriculture and food production systems, how we can work on it both from behavioral perspective as well as from a systemic perspective to improve the diet diversity. One important thing that actually leads us to have very reduced choices is income. Now, does income help us in eating all the food groups? When you look at the data, what it shows, definitely milk and milk product consumption is strongly linked with income. So as income will improve, the consumption of milk and milk products will go up. But what will not change significantly is consumption of protein-rich foods. Even fruits and vegetables are not strongly associated with income in the context of children. So these are much more coming from a behavioral or a preference perspective and not directly from income perspective, because income is not showing a steep gradient with all food groups. So this has to be kept in mind that not all of it is poverty. There is something else to this story. Now, why these things are very important? From a policy perspective, the POSHAN targets include not only anthropometric failure, but also anemia. But can improving diet itself, diet which is a major part to help our body get the macro and micronutrients, can this help us to accelerate our progress towards the POSHAN targets? So if you will just roughly see what is the diet pattern of the best performing districts on, say, stunting, or the best performing districts on underweight, and compare them with the worst performing districts. Is there any difference between the best and worst performance in terms of the diet composition? You will see there is a clear difference. One thing is that the consumption of better districts in terms of protein or fruits and vegetables is relatively higher than compared to districts which are showing much, much poor performance in terms of anthropometric failure. You will find same pattern when you compare stunting, when you compare underweight, or when you compare anemia. So you, for example, in this slide, you can see that districts who are having low prevalence of anemia, they are showing much better intake of eggs, much better intake of fish, poultry, so even much better intake of fruits and vegetables compared to districts which are having very, very high levels of anemia. So diet is having a very clear resemblance in terms of the profile of the children in those particular areas. We also did a population attributable risk analysis just to see whether diet can make a significant difference to the POSHAN targets. So as you all may know that POSHAN targets aim to reduce anthropometric failure by 2 percentage points per annum and anemia by 3 percentage points per annum. So these are already very ambitious targets. But when you look at the diet in this context, we can see that improved consumption of protein can actually help us to achieve 6% reduction in the current prevalence rates. This is actually a very significant amount given that various other factors are not actually contributing to that much. So a clear message that we are finding is that protein intake and fruits and vegetables consumption can clearly help us to reduce the prevalence, and it can in a short period help you to accelerate our progress towards the POSHAN targets. Now, given the income story, another thing which we noted was that where preferences are coming into play, we see that maternal education is playing a very, very significant role. And this is very consistent across all the food groups. As you might have seen previously, income was not related much with the protein intake or the fruit and vegetable intake on a regular basis. But maternal education is clearly showing that children who have educated mothers, their protein intake as well as fruit and vegetable intake is very, very high. So this is something very, very strong message which is coming out and which is beyond income domain. So we have to work more on these aspects. Now, given the highlights on children, I will just try to briefly give some picture about the food intake patterns among women and compare it with the intake pattern among men. So when we look at these broad food groups, one important point we notice is that although, say, green leafy vegetables or pulses and beans, men and women, they tend to have similar kind of consumption pattern in terms of reporting, whether they eat this on a daily basis or a weekly basis. But once we come to fruits or when you come to eggs or other protein-rich food like fish, chicken or meat, men tend to consume more of that compared to women. So there is a clear divide whether it is associated with income or is it a preference pattern or there is some kind of gender norm playing around here. This pattern is clear that women are eating less of protein and vegetables. So this is something worth addressing from our policies. An interesting and very critical factor that we see when we compare data for the last 10 years is that the consumption of dark green leafy vegetables has come down. So earlier it was eaten on a more regular basis, but now that has come down. So this is more disturbing. And these changes we cannot explain without looking into other factors which are directly coming from the agriculture sector, from the pricing perspective, the inflation around food prices. So these things are actually contributing and shaping our food preferences. And one evidence of that we will find is in terms of the picture of income-related consumption patterns. So here you will see that again, protein is not much linked with income, but you will clearly find that intake of milk products, intake of fruits, very, very strongly linked to income. So families who are prosperous are actually eating more of fruits and vegetables, whereas the poorer families are not getting this right. So what is more critical here is to not only work on the preferences from the household perspective, but also look at the supply side, try to integrate and improve our systems, and try to make it much more affordable and accessible to the poorer household. But while we are looking at this aspect of consumption from a deprivation perspective, I would also like to caution this from a broader perspective of nutrition or malnutrition in general. So just to leave you with this particular distribution of BMI, both from the WHO cutoff perspective, which we feel is not very appropriate in the Indian context, and we also have a different Asian cutoff for the BMI. If you will just look at the WHO cutoff, in the last 10 years, what has happened? The percentage of women in the age group 15 to 49 who were earlier considered to be overweight or obese, that number has gone up significantly. In fact, if you will look at the Asian cutoff or even the WHO cutoff, presently we have more number of overweight or obese women than compared to underweight women. So this is a clearly disturbing trend which is coming up, and one has to very closely examine our diets and work on some of this. So just to before conclude, of course there are limitations around what kind of data and the recall issues and measurement issues, but broad descriptive patterns will suggest us that there is a clear stagnation of intake of fruits and vegetables in our country. It is not going up despite our economic growth, despite our income improvement. The intake of fresh fruits, vegetables, it's not going up. Another thing is that we have to strengthen our agriculture, especially to improve access of these things in drier regions like Rajasthan or MP or Maharashtra, which are heavily dependent on rain-fed agriculture. So certain policies which are required for such high burden, arid and semi-arid areas are very, very important. One important factor that we noted from the portion perspective is that fruits and vegetables, and particularly protein-rich foods, will be very, very important for accelerating our progress or trying to achieve the target set by the policy. And finally, like 3 points worth noting, green leafy vegetables, clearly there is significant reduction both in rural urban areas, and role of income we cannot negate, but then there is an important behavioral dimension to our intake patterns. And finally, we have to also be wary of the fact that overnutrition is also as big as a problem in India as compared to undernutrition. So this is also very strongly linked to several other CVD risk factors, and which we cannot discount while we are working more on the undernutrition side. So with that, thank you so much for your attention. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Dr. Joe. So we have listened to 5 speakers. So now the house is open for questions. अग्रवाल इधर आना पड़ेगा सर
थैंक यू वेरी मच फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई एम थैंकफुल टू द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स फॉर पुटिंग अप दिस वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इशू दैट इज प्लेगिंग अवर कंट्री देर आर मेनी इश्यूज दैट नीड डिस्कशन मे नॉट बी पॉसिबल हियर बट I will like to flag some of those starting from the last presentation. The key message seems to be that our diet lacks in proteins. So we will like to know how low protein intake is linked with anemia. It is important, protein should be there, but what is the direct linkage of low protein diet with anemia? This is one. Number two, it seems to be propagating that take eggs and fish and poultry products. It means non-vegetarian diets. So how to improve proteins among vegetarians, that should be one very, very important issue that should be flagged, that we should know. And how we say that in terms of wealth quintiles, the fruit intakes, et cetera, is among the rich people. So how fruit intake is linked with anemia. We understand vitamin C that we can have from the other cheaper products as well. So from the diet perspective,
these are some of the issues that need discussion. Now, another very, very important change in this is digital hemoglobinometers. And this is what we say that we are very good in policy, but we don't give framework for implementation. And this is where the states are struggling, like Dr. Mangala Sood said. The same problem is there with other states. There are many digital hemoglobinometers. She was referring about HemoQ, I think, that it cost in thousands, and then the qubit is also very costly. Now there is true HB meter also that Niti Aayog is also propagating. It costs around 8,000 or so and about 20 per strip. And there are many other point of care digital hemoglobinometers. So if government can come out that these are the equipment which states can buy, then they can procure very easily. So how to facilitate states to procure a method that has been approved by Government of India, and that is on the GEM portal also, so that you can facilitate. So this is one very, very important intervention. And one thing I want to know is that why this change in 100 mg from 100 mg to 60 mg has been made? Why? What is the rationale of this change? If 100 mg was not required, what it means is that for all these years, we were giving 100 mg. It was close to the therapeutic dose. It means each and every, we were saying all these years that we just give the prophylactic dose, we don't test, and we don't give the therapeutic dose. But if we were giving 100 mg, that was close to the therapeutic dose, it means whatever compliance was there, they were getting the therapeutic dose. And last point is that in this 6x6x6 strategy, why we have left out Ayush? Why we think that iron and folic acid is the only answer? Are there good Ayurvedic preparations that can also be used? And because I have given one PhD top thesis to one of the students, and I learned that these Ayurvedic preparations are in the drug kit of the ASHA workers even. So why we are not including these Ayush therapies when we know that government is propagating this, and you have Ayush practitioners down to the PhD level. Their services can be used to tackle these types of things. Instead of having bridge course and asking these practitioners to do very advanced things, they can contribute in management of anemia and malnutrition. Thank you very much.
I don't know where to start. I think there must be 15 different questions, and the breadth and the details probably will be difficult for me. So those which I recall correctly, I will try to address them. Rest, I will probably have a tea with Dr. Agrawal and explain to him. As far as digital hemoglobinometer, because that was mentioned by Dr. Mangala also, the government has already budgeted for the states 5,000 rupees for digital hemoglobinometer and entire cost of the cuvette. Now, if you look at the market, and I take, I'm not propagating any particular brand. I'm just saying that there are digital hemoglobinometers, even the ones that was mentioned by brand name, they are coming within the range of 3,000 to 5,000. And therefore, central government has said is that they will give 2,500 from the central component, and the state has to put in another 2,500 to procure the digital hemoglobinometer. The total cost of microcuvettes will be borne by the central government. So and there are many states which are already doing it. I am not too certain what is the bottleneck as far as Himachal Pradesh is concerned. So maybe we can discuss with the program officer and try to explain how to go about it. Silase is a very poor method. It is imperative that you have point of care testing. Particularly, it is important because after you start the treatment, you need to monitor whether or not the person is responding. Because if the person does not respond within 2 months, that person needs further advanced investigation. So we cannot assume that it is only because of iron deficiency, and therefore good quality point of care treatment is necessary. The other question that I recall was about change in dose. So my take on that is that we should not fear change. but we should not change because of fear. See, so initially we had 60 milligram, as was explained by Dr. Shikha. Then we changed to 100 milligram, and now we have come back to 60 milligram. The genesis is basically the review that has taken place at Geneva by World Health Organization, and that is a recommendation. Then we had an international national consultation at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, I think about three or four, April we had, where people or those who are working in anemia or iron deficiency anemia were invited. And this was a consensus decision that was taken at that particular meeting. And the proceedings of most of the meetings are actually in the form of publication, which is a special edition on anemia. And this was published in IJCH. I forget the, but it just came after April this, 2018. So if you look at it, many of the questions that you have raised are actually discussed and deliberated, and the answers are there. It will be asking too much for me to address all the related questions that you have put. So, and therefore, I will request you to have a look at that particular issue of IJCH, so you will get some of the answers. As far as IUC is concerned, nobody is barring them to carry on their business. But from allopathic point of view, I am not going to say that my allopathic doctor should start prescribing IUSH drug. IUSH drug is best prescribed by the practitioner who are qualified to do so. So, and that's the reason it is missing during the course of presentation by the team that is here. If I've missed anything, I put it on my poor recall of memory. Thank you.
Any other question?
So thank you very much for putting on this very important panel. And I would like to especially thank Dr. William, because it was a very interesting presentation in one way that we were looking at dietary patterns vis-a-vis the income sort of thing. I have another take on the same thing. It's a contrarian take. We are looking from a demand side perspective. What about the supply side? Suppose the income pattern, with the income pattern, the protein consumption grows. Suppose we, as an agency, we promote the protein uptake. Are we still in a position to supply that amount of the increased protein? Even if you look at the Food Security Act, it only covers the cereal part. Even at a policy level from the government side, we are trying to secure only the carbohydrate consumption pattern. So whatever we are talking, there are several missing links, even the policy sort of segment. And if you look at the agricultural data, the acreage which is under cultivation, that is on the very, very higher side on the rice, on the cereal side. So again, coming to that point, even when we look at the pulses acreage data, there is every another alternate year, there's a shortage of pulses. So even the middle class or the upper income group who has the capacity to purchase, they are not able to purchase it. So now what is your take on this kind of situation?
So I will ask Dr. William those to respond, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Very important question, actually, because diet is not a one-sided phenomenon. There are, even on the demand side, many things at play: preferences, income, awareness. So many things are at play. And very important part is the supply side, like what are we producing. So as you have like seen, the availability in some sense determines what are we eating. If we are staying in coastal areas where fish will be aplenty, a lot of people end up eating fish. If we are in the interiors, it will be largely agriculture based and crops which are suitable to that particular region. Now many of the crops which are nutritious are not necessarily grown in that area. How can we improve our agriculture supply system, which can then help us improve our consumption profile? So there are certainly many things which are going on, and diet is not necessarily only a one-sided factor here. Even the government has understood this. There are a lot of efforts between the health sector and the agriculture sector. Initiatives are going on where they are trying to talk to each other and make efforts to promote production of diets which can be much more nutritious from a perspective of availability at a particular point. So the agri-nutrition linkage is very strongly taken by the government, and we can see many, many initiatives which are coming up to strengthen these linkages. So definitely we are not leaving anything to a particular side. We understand it's a multifactorial phenomena, And we have to work on different aspects. If we have to improve the nutrition profile by working both from a community perspective, or we want to work with the policy, with the systems, trying to improve the economic aspects of this. So thank you so much.
Any other question?
I'm Dr. Oman Nazir from the Department of Community Medicine and Government Medical College, Srinagar. I have a question for Dr. William. So you have taken the diet survey and you have used the method, 24-hour recall method. Is it a best way to represent the data? We have best choice as 24-hour recall method, because we have 3 days, we have 5 days. Can we take this representative for this? And my second question is to Dr. Kapil, sir. So what are the policies, as we had to screen the children in the schools also? Have you taken the board, the advocacy done on the school levels? Because when we had to go to school for screening for the Anemia Mukt Bharat, has the education department been taken on board in this aspect? Is there an integration between the departments on this level? Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your question. I think it's a very, very challenging job to ask education department to do something. I am struggling to get health system to do something. So it's a very important area, and rightly said, it will not work unless until education department is on board. But unfortunately, our RIT doesn't run there. We try our advocacy at the best. We are struggling. It's one of the limitations, but we have to overcome that to achieve anemia control. Thank you.
First part of the question pertained to Dr. Williams.
Thank you, sir. Of course, I totally agree with you. Data has several limitations, and we have to strengthen our nutrition research and work more on that. So I totally agree that there are limitations, but it was just a broad trend from available data. Thank you.
Sir, government alone, any country may not be able to do, because even we males also have to consume food every day. Not only the antenatal cases. So we have got several occasions where we will come in contact with the beneficiaries, right from LKG. HNE, health and nutrition education, is part and parcel of ICDS functions. So in the due course, we have to impart long-term basis, more importance for nutrition education, so that every person knows what to eat. It is not the money that they don't have. I will share my experience in 1 minute. I am in a private medical college. People are not poor, those who are coming to our college. They can take care of themselves, but they should know what to eat. There are some, and how do I come in contact? I am running dedicated vaccination clinic. One side is OBG, other side is a pediatrics. Antenatal cases come for TT. When they are coming for TT immunization, they will be in the clinic for 20 minutes. In this 20 minutes, we will be doing this education program. I just take history, what is taken, breakfast and all. Then I will come to know whether they are taking green leafy vegetables or not. What is the importance of that? They should start taking it. They are saving money by taking green leafy vegetables, because other vegetables are costlier than that. This they are not knowing. So money is not alone. If we involve ourselves in the program, many things can be solved without money. Thank you, sir.
The example which you gave, many of the medical colleges are following it. So I hope all medical colleges will follow this advice. So thank you, sir, for supporting. Any other question?
So I am Dr. Kuldeep Singh Marturia. I am Department of the Health and Family Welfare, Uttarakhand. My question regarding anemia is to Mr. William Jo. As his studies shows that this green leafy vegetables trend has gone down. What I see, if you cook the green leafy vegetable in a family size 5, you need a huge amount of green leafy vegetable to be cooked, right, to get the required moment. And what I have read lately, that one of the most eaten green leafy vegetable is palak. And palak decreases palak has a phytate and decreases the absorption of the iron. So I think it's a better trend that people are not eating green leafy vegetables. And second thing regarding policy matter is, whenever the government procures this iron and folic acid tablets, because the procurement is at a huge label, all the iron folic acid tablets in the hospital are kept in very shady areas that decrease their product values. So people are not eating the iron and folic acid because of that thing. So something should be done. And third point was the acceptability of the syrups bottle of iron is more than the iron tablets. So there should be more encouragement towards from the government policy to have more of a syrup bottles rather than iron tablets.
Is it taken? Any other questions?
Sir, I just wanted to know about iron, like green leafy vegetables. Why we are promoting in every forum that green leafy eat green leafy vegetables?
Sir, the phytates actually inhibit or decrease the iron absorption, but it doesn't means it sends it to minus. If I am not taking palak, I'm not getting anything at all. If I take palak, I'll get at least 5 milligrams of iron. So it's still better than having nothing. So this thing, everything will have some inhibitors, there are promoters. So we have to be mindful of that.
No, just imagine a family of five and you want 5 grams of, milligram of iron to, how much like a green vegetable you have to cook. Just imagine that fact.
It's not just more of a question, it's more of a suggestion probably, because we are about 450 medical colleges. There was a point raised that we are having only like 1 day survey was done in this case. All the medical colleges are part of Department of Community Medicine postings and family study is being done. So through IAPSM, if we can ensure that all the 450 medical colleges, 1 year data of families what they're covering, just pool up the data and we can give it to the ministry itself, and we'll be having a better data itself of 3 days or 5 days. We can have a fixed thing. We want 3 days data, 5 days data. That'll give a more better picture, I suppose. That's
it. Thanks to the audience. We have been running late, but you showed your enthusiasm and encouragement to us by your presence. Thank you very much. I also thank the panelists who have come from Delhi, and the local panelists also, and Dr. Bhardwaj for assisting in holding this panel presentation. And lastly, but not the least, the organizers for having such an excellent facility and making this a success. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, dignitaries. For felicitation, may I now request Dr. A.K. Bhardwaj to kindly felicitate Dr. Shashikant. I request Dr. Puneet Mishra from AIIMS Delhi to kindly come over the stage to felicitate Ms. Shikha Yadav. Dr. Puneet Mishra. May I request Dr. Arun Agarwal from PGI to kindly come over the stage to felicitate Dr. Kapil Yadav. I request Dr. Surya Bali to kindly come over the stage to felicitate Dr. Farhad Ahmed. I request Dr. Mohan Dolbole to kindly come over the stage to felicitate Dr. William Jo. Thank you, dignitaries. May I request all dignitaries to kindly come ahead for a group photograph.